Hello, everyone. Welcome to another Vanguard live stream. Got a super special guest, friend of the show today, Jordan Cheriton of Status Quo, and we're about to be welcoming him onto the stream. Before we do so, as always, a quick shout out to the Patreon community. Thanks to everyone supporting the show on patreon.com/thevanguardchannel. Really does keep what we do possible and is the best way to support the show. So if you'd like to do so and join our community, get access to some of our benefits like our Discord server and book club episodes, then you can hit up that link in the description, patreon.com/thevanguardchannel. But yeah, we do like to start and end our streams with a big sincere shout out to our patron community and everyone supporting us there. So thanks so much. And without further ado, I guess we can get started with today's interview. Like I said, special guest, friend of the show, returning for the third time to the Vanguard, is Jordan Cheriton of Status Quo. How you doing, Jordan?
I'm good. I kind of want to, like, if you guys could send it to me, I want that your opener to be my alarm when I wake up, because that's really fucking...
Yeah, shout out to my good homie Sam Lipset for recording that for the Vanguard for free. We do appreciate that.
It definitely gets you hyped up to hear the news, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, man, definitely.
For sure. Well, thanks so much for joining us today, Jordan. A lot of reporting of yours that I want to discuss today. Some really important stuff going on around the country. I guess a good place to start would be the strikes that have been going on, specifically the John Deere strikes. I know you were just in Ohio, correct, covering the strikes?
Yeah, I was in Iowa, where there's many, many locations that are on strike. Illinois, kind of the border, the Quad Cities area, where there's Illinois-Iowa border. So there were a few in Illinois. There's also in Kansas, which I didn't go to, and a couple locations in Georgia. So I primarily went to picket lines in Iowa and Illinois.
Yeah, I wanted to ask you about that experience broadly and you know, what you were able to glean from the reporters. You know, obviously mainstream media has done just an absolutely atrocious job of giving these people any coverage. So really what we have to work with is the on the ground reporting that people like Status Quo is providing us, which we really appreciate and thank you for it. You know, I wanted to just, you know, see if you could relay some of the talk that's been going on these picket lines. Obviously, there's been a tremendous effort from John Deere to just crack down on these strikers in the most brutal ways, forcing them to cross heavy traffic, four or five lanes, 55 miles an hour cars speeding by. I read that tragically a UAW union striker was killed demonstrating. Could you just talk about, you know, what's going on there, you know, what the mood is and you know, I guess how people's spirits are doing?
Yeah, I mean, as somebody who's seen the highs of the progressive movement and kind of workers, you know, kind of Bernie 1620, and obviously the lows, which has been the Biden administration and progressives, obviously not totally in unison. Honestly, this is invigorating for me, because when you're out there, I mean, there is a real worker revolt happening in the country. I don't want to oversell it, but each place I went to, it's the same exact message, which is like, we got nothing more to lose. I mean, honestly, between 30 years of concessions that we've made, you know, a lot of these workers, even what John Deere offered would have been a pay cut when you factor in inflation compared to what they made 10 years ago. So that's the 40-year neoliberal theft of their money towards their CEOs. And then COVID. I mean, I think COVID waked a lot of people up to the fact that, I mean, one worker, for example, said something so powerful. And it was like, you know, corporate media made us believe that we should just be happy to have something, just be happy to have a job, just be happy to have some retirement. And I think COVID for a lot of these workers I spoke with kind of just popped that propaganda, because they realized even during a pandemic, they weren't getting massive hazard pay. They weren't getting much of anything, while John Deere, I mean, it's about to make $6 billion, a record in profit. So I think a lot of these workers that kind of, in this neoliberal, you know, controlled demolition of the working class, that they kind of just accepted it for many years, are now saying, no, no more. We see the numbers they're making. We see that we're working 10 to 12 hour shifts, three Saturdays out of the month, that they're offering new workers essentially to cut their pensions completely. And a lot of these corporations and a lot of these companies with these workers, people might not realize, they're in many cases the biggest employer in the cities, in the communities. So it's not, you know, yeah, maybe the current worker will get a couple extra bucks on this contract, but their nephew that works at John Deere or their kid that's going to be working at John Deere would get rump roast. So I think collectively you have a tipping point of just the demolition of the working class, plus COVID has basically just fed up these people.
Yeah, that's super good insight, Jordan. And like I said, you've done great reporting from the picket lines. It seems like there's definitely a shift in the air when it comes to the dynamic between workers and the bosses right now in this country. It seems like there's these strikes going on everywhere. What do you think has kind of triggered this mass uprising? And do you think it really will kind of lead to a reset of the balance between worker union power and the bosses and corporations?
Yeah, I think there's multiple things. Like I mentioned, I think COVID played a part. I also think there's another, I've always said, every story I've covered, like workers, community activists are way more fucking intelligent and articulate than any of the cosmopolitan assholes on CNN pontificating. But a lot of these folks have said to me, and some of them are Bernie people, some of them are kind of Trump people, that essentially them waking up to how basically empty and hollow the whole political system is, has basically forced them to act. Like maybe, you know, a lot of them bought into like the Democratic Party bullshit of the last 30 years of like, we're, you know, raising wages and, you know, Biden, you know, Wall Street didn't build the country, the middle class did. And then, you know, essentially Democrats come in and feed them all that virtue signaling, but sell them down the river. And I think a lot of them have wised up to it. And now that there's really no like Republican boogeyman like Trump or any of that stuff, they're just saying like, all right, we've delivered for you. We voted for Obama twice. I mean, Iowa is Republican now. They voted for Obama twice. And what have they gotten for it? I mean, that's the feedback I'm getting from them. They don't expect anything from the Republicans, but since the Democrats, they're realizing is really just kind of like a marketing exercise rather than actual delivering anything or even fighting for them, even at all fighting for them. I mean, Biden, many of them slammed Biden's, you know, neutral statements. Oh, they have a right to do this. So I think they're just kind of finally realizing what a lot of us on the left have been saying, that whatever, you could vote for people you believe in, but that's not gonna change the system. The only way to actually exert power is through withholding your labor and making the corporations feel the pain.
Yeah. Could you talk to us a little bit about what are the demands that these strikers are looking for? You know, obviously that, you know, these people are living, you know, not necessarily the most affluent jobs, right? It's not like they're out here, you know, looking for fat paycheck raises. They're not out here, you know, trying to buy their second hobby cars, right? These are people that are in middle America, places where it's relatively, you know, less expensive to live if you can find a job that will pay you enough to, you know, sustain a lifestyle. It's, you know, so it feels to me from everything that I've seen, these are very modest requests from these workers. You know, they want to make, exponentially more, but not that much more money. It seems like to a lot of people who make their living in the cities or, you know, in more metropolitan areas, this should be a no-brainer for the John Deere Corporation. I mean, we've seen the disasters that come when they tried to bring the schlubs from the office jobs at John Deere onto the factory floor. This is clearly a very skilled job. This is a job where, you know, if you aren't familiar with the safety precautions and, you know, how to do this work, that it will cause disasters for the company. So it seems like their compensation should be relatively like, oh yeah, you know, we will pay you an adequate wage. But could you just walk people through the specific demands that these John Deere workers in the UAW are presenting?
Yeah. So it kind of gets in the weeds, but if many people might not know, not just John Deere, but a lot of these companies try to exert this two-tier system, which is actually dividing the workers. So in 1997, their last change, where they were offering current workers XYZ in terms of wages, pension, healthcare, but new workers coming in after that would get far less. And the union and the workers accepted that, because labor was, you know, hollowed out and a shell, and they just accepted whatever they could get. John Deere has been trying to do that similar thing, but now kind of on steroids in terms of, all right, we'll offer the current workers maybe over the next 4 or 5 years, $5-6 more an hour, but new workers won't get that. And new workers, oh, by the way, you're not going to even get a pension. from us. So there is a solidarity. You guys use the word comrade a lot. There is a camaraderie that I'm seeing, because those new workers, by the way, the future workers are not like some distant people that the current workers don't know. Like I said, nephews, sons, grandkids, like John Deere is the biggest employer in a lot of these communities. So there's a solidarity about not selling the future workers out. And the other thing is, for the current workers, you know, John Deere, it's not just about the wages. I think that's what the media focuses on. I mean, these people have, these workers have to work like 2-3 Saturdays out of every month. These workers are working 10 to 12 hours a day. The conditions are not the safest. These workers are being asked, have constantly been asked to pay more for their health care, even though this company is profiting hand over fist. So the specific demands are definitely more in terms of pay increase than John Deere offered. No changes to the pensions, which John Deere wants to change their pensions, as well as, you know, definitely reforming the hours they work, the days, the overtime, because John Deere, like the rest of them, is essentially trying to, through accounting gimmicks and things like that, not have to hire additional workers, just squeeze as much juice out of the orange from these current workers. So that their main demands are the pay, but also the hours and shoring up their pensions and healthcare benefits.
And just in case there are any Zoomers like us that are listening, pensions are almost, that's almost like a foreign word to people who are our age. Like, what the fuck kind of, what is a pension? Like, jobs actually used to give people money for retirement. It's a crazy thing that should have never disappeared, right? It actually makes a lot of sense. You commit, you know, 10, 20, 30 years to a company and they make sure that you can, you know, retire in some semblance of dignity. But I feel like, you know, after all of the big auto plants that were, you know, a backbone of this country's economy were sent overseas, you know, after NAFTA and all this kind of stuff, that idea of a pension completely disappeared. It's almost not even negotiated in any job that I've ever, you know, pursued myself, or even that I know anybody that ever has. Could you just for a couple of minutes talk about why that's so important for a community like this? You know, as you age out, especially as a physically demanding job, you're just not going to have the ability to survive solely off of a Social Security income. And again, a low wage job doesn't necessarily provide you with the means to, you know, save 20% of your income throughout your life to, you know, create a nest egg for when you do have to retire.
Right. No, the pension is super important because, as you said, I mean, Social Security, that's not going to do it. So pensions for a lot of these company employers, you know, maybe in the 1950s and 60s, a job at John Deere, the pension was less important because you were making decent wages. You had vibrant benefits. Labor unions were much, much stronger back in the day. So your protections were better. Your pensions were better, this and that. And also, there wasn't this massive inflation as there is, you know, these days. So back then, you know, maybe one parent could work and the other one could stay home. But now, I mean, they're talking, you know, Manchin and these people are talking about inflation. Well, they don't talk about the inflation that is gentrification, i.e. economic terrorism in most of these places, which everything has been going up for years and years and years, and these people are being priced out of where they live. So the pensions are super important because this is their retirement. This is their ability to pay for their health care, because Medicare, a lot of people on Medicare need a supplement, a supplemental insurance. The other thing with pensions is, this is in the weeds, so I won't bore your audience, but just think about, like, you know, roulette at the casino. A lot of these corporations and investors have been investing these workers' pensions and literally losing them. At the 2008 financial crash, a lot of these workers' pensions were cut in half, along with their 401k, because of the greed and, you know, reckless betting on Wall Street.
Criminality.
So their pensions aren't even fully what they have put in, because a lot of it has been cut. So the pensions are super important. And frankly, a lot of these workers, you know, John Deere and the media has, you know, just done their stenography, keep saying, oh, these average worker makes 60 grand a year. I spoke of workers, most of them are making, if they're lucky, 40 to 45,000. And John Deere is specifically trying to cap their hours so that they won't get overtime and just do accounting tricks. So even if they do work overtime, they're not paid the full overtime. So the pension for any worker who works with their hands, you know, showers after work, all that thing is, you know, is the Holy Christ.
Absolutely. Well, I did want to shout out a few super chats. Thanks, Adam, for the $5. Definitely don't agree with Jimmy on everything, and hopefully we'll do a pet live stream in the near future. We can show off Malcolm. Thanks, Kimberly, for the $4.99. Yeah, definitely echo that. Amazing reporting coming out of Iowa from Jordan. And thank you, Emma, as well, for the $5. West Coast Kaiser pickets next Wednesday due to an unsafe staffing shortage. Solidarity. So thank you for that comment and donation as well. I did want to pivot a little bit, and
I should just mention, by the way, John Deere is 10,000 workers striking. Kaiser Permanente, which might go on strike next, is 24,000 workers. So this thing is spreading, and it seems to be getting bigger from one company to the next.
Absolutely. Yeah, 100%. And I do want to talk about Steve Donziger, but since someone just brought it up in the chat, this is also something I've been dying to talk to you about. Asking you about how you feel about the progressives holding the line now that the bill has been cut down to nothing but another handout to the rich. Of course, talking about Joe Biden's Build Back Better plan, which has been gutted before our eyes from $3.5 trillion down to $1 trillion plus, essentially. Looks like it's going to be a total handout, as this commenter says, to the rich. Well, basically all of the provisions that would have helped the working class and the environment have been, you know, systematically stripped from it by the, you know, at the whim of Joe Manchin, Kyrsten Sinema, et cetera. So what's your opinion on that? And do you actually think that the likes of Bernie Sanders and the squad in the House of Representatives will hold the line and vote this thing down in its current form? Or do you think they'll fold?
I think they're going to fold. I think they should vote it down. But I think they're going to fold. I credited them when they held the line in terms of not voting for this shitty bipartisan infrastructure deal, which is just a privatization scheme on steroids, the separate bipartisan deal that Manchin and all the corporate vultures want. Because, you know, that's the first time they've organized as a bloc to at least take an action. So that was good. But I started realizing this was going off the tracks because I kept saying, I don't understand. Why don't you go to West Virginia, all of you? Why don't you go to Arizona? Why don't you hold rallies? I've reported in West Virginia. They want everything that's in that bill and then more. It's West Virginia was a Democratic state 10 years ago for a century. The only reason it's moved right is because of people like Joe Manchin and the Democratic Party moving right and not actually offering a populist alternative. So I don't understand why they did this inside baseball stuff when they could have held massive rallies publicly shaming Joe Manchin, publicly shaming Kyrsten Sinema. Ro Khanna, when I interviewed him, kind of dismissed that. Like,
great interview, by the way.
Oh, thank you. I don't know why that would matter. Well, I don't know. Bernie wrote a newspaper op-ed and it kind of ruffled Manchin's feather. Bernie, former AOC staffers, people might not know this, but her former chief of staff and communications person, they started a super PAC. First thing they did was go on the air with radio ads in West Virginia attacking Manchin in January because he was against the $2,000 checks. And then he started backpedaling. So I don't understand Ro Khanna and these others. Like, yeah, they go on CNN and they talk tough and stuff, but like Manchin could be shamed. He is shameful. He is corrupt, but he's a human being. Nobody likes to be shit on their doorstep. Sinema, I don't know what she is. I'm not going to get into that, but I think she could be shamed. So I think outside of initially voting, not refusing to vote for the deal, I think they played this wrong. And to me, listen, I've defended Bernie Sanders a lot. I don't think he's a sellout, but I'm going to call it what it is. This is a legacy moment for Bernie Sanders. He has the ability to stop this. His whole thing has been red line, yep. Expanding Medicare, dental, vision, hearing, which also matters for you and I, by the way, because we're not of age yet. But if you move that Overton window to you're not just getting regular health, but vision, hearing, and dental, then for Medicare for all, that's already normalized. That's already part of it, the vision, hearing, and dental. I think he should vote no. I think he should say there's no we have complete control. And if we accept this, the same thing is going to happen that happened in 2010. Obama pushed, proposed a massively insufficient stimulus bill. The Democrats negotiated against themselves on Obamacare, and you had the Tea Party wave come in. And I would say, if I were Bernie, I would say I cannot in good conscience vote for this. And also on the climate piece, because that's the marketing and branding that's coming out now. Oh, it might be $500 billion, the biggest climate investment ever. $500 billion is half a Band-Aid to a gaping climate inferno. So listen, I haven't really been quite on the Jimmy Dore thing where they're all Lucifer, but I cannot say that I would vote no, and I think they should be criticized when they fold.
Right. No, I totally agree with that. And obviously, it's worth mentioning, too, that Joe Biden, the president himself, hasn't gone to West Virginia either to try to pressure Joe Manchin into, you know, helping to enact his agenda. It is his agenda. He has the bully pulpit as president. He's not using it for anything. He's basically folded every time.
I thought he was the guy that gets things done. That's what we were fed.
Yeah, exactly. The new FDR. Right. I totally agree. It's been, you know, not just disappointing, but straight up confusing, the strategy of the progressives. And, you know, you mentioned Ro Khanna. I was just watching him on the Bad Faith podcast by Brianna Joy Gray, and he's defending the bill before it even is voted on. He's out here saying it's going to be a good bill. We're going to be proud to vote and, you know, vote for it and pass it, essentially. I just don't understand it. Isn't it your job to be the left flank, not defend and, you know, run cover for this bill, which has so clearly been gutted at the whim of corporate extremists? I just truly don't understand.
I think Ro Khanna and all of them are deathly afraid, and this was the same problem Bernie had, of being painted by the media as, you know, arsonists, political terrorists, and that the progressives are obstructing change, because that's how the media would frame it. And I say to that, well, what's the alternative, Ro? I mean, what is the alternative? Okay, the deal passes. Nothing really changes. Even the universal pre-K is means tested if you actually read the plan. And then we start running for 2022 under vote blue no matter who. Republicans bad, even though Trump's not in it. There's still, I mean, Terry McAuliffe's campaign in Virginia is all Trump and just trying to paint his opponent as Trump. So to me,
even though he hasn't even been endorsed by Trump, right? Glenn Youngkin hasn't even been endorsed by Trump.
Right. So progressives fundamentally misunderstand to me that, you know, at the end of the day, it's a lose-lose. You're either going to be painted by the media that way if you actually fight, or you're going to be painted, or you're going to be marginalized by the media, and the media is going to help rig the campaigns against you anyway. So why not change? You know, my partner Jen talks about a pattern interrupt. Why don't you do a pattern interrupt and actually fight? Go hold those rallies. Go say, no, no, no. I wish Bernie during the campaign, I think Kyle mentioned this during the campaign, why didn't Bernie keep saying, no, 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 no. Let me tell you what's actually radical. What's actually radical is 500,000 people are sleeping on the streets. That's actually radical. And other countries look at us in absolute puzzlement and are dumbfounded. What's radical is literally people are rationing insulin. That would be radical. Progressives need to change the paradigm. But the problem is, you know, I'm not picking on Ro Khanna, but Ro Khanna and a lot of these progressives are not firebrands. I mean, even AOC and these folks that were firebrands before, you know, they've kind of got in and been seduced with this long game thinking. Well, I don't know. I mean, I'm a little older than you guys, but I don't really think all of us have 30, 40 years to wait for this long game. And I would rather, if I'm progressives, you have the people behind you. The majority of people would gravitate towards you if you were out there fighting. And you know what? Manchin and Sinema, they'll hold it up. So why don't you do the same thing and hold it up? I don't understand it. And frankly, this is why in 2024, we'd have a choice between, you know, Pete, because Kamala seems on the out, and whoever, I mean,
Game. Yeah, you're totally right, though, about the long game thinking. Going back to that Bad Faith interview with Ro Khanna, he basically said that in his view, the Build Back Better plan is building blocks so that in the next 10 to 15 years, we can start to actually get some fundamental systematic change, which is funny because maybe just a month ago or so, they were saying that the Build Back Better plan was fundamental change, that it was, you know, the biggest, most impressive, you know, working class deal that would help this country and abolish poverty and all this bullshit. But now they're saying it's building blocks so that in a decade or two, we can have some nice things. It's just crazy how they keep, you know, moving the goalposts, changing the way they talk about this, and really just proving that they're not fighting behind the scenes. They're going to fold. They're going to go with it no matter what. And they have no backbone, which brings me no pleasure to say.
Well, I also think there's another element, and, you know, not that I'm caring I'm not comparing Obama to Bernie, obviously very different, but progressives are making the same mistake Obama made. Obama, you know, he obviously was bought off by Wall Street, but he also built the biggest digital army at that time ever. And instead of using it as president to apply pressure to for single payer or for actual substantive policy, he just totally did not utilize his digital army. Actually, not only a digital army, that physical bodies that would have came out and just went along with the Chamber of Commerce and, you know, Obamacare and all that crap while continuing to bomb, you know, 10 other countries. Bernie and the squad, they have a massive army. Obviously, we know the left has been fractured online. You know, that's another story. But I mean, you have a massive army ready at your disposal to fight. They're just looking for the permission. They're just looking for you to take the lead. Bernie's the one that said, oh no, when I'm in the White House, the first thing I'm doing isn't meeting with McConnell to compromise. It's meeting with McConnell and telling him, look outside the window. Here's my army. I mean, you still have that army. Sure. I mean, there's a lot of people that have fallen out and are hopeless and angry. But I think those people, if they saw the people that they have been disappointed with starting to fight with hardline positions, they could become activated again. But I'm not seeing that fight. And, you know, Roe and Bernie or whatever, it's not good enough to just sell it as, yeah, you know, the number was cut by $6 trillion because it was originally supposed to be six. And yeah, there's no Medicare expansion. And, oh, you know, the billionaire tax isn't really a billionaire tax, but, you know, universal pre-K and, you know, we'll get back at it in 2024. You're going to lose the entire movement. If you keep doing that, you know, to be fair, progressives don't have the White House, progressives don't have majorities. But what you do have, which we have seen them you exercise at least once, is your vote. That's your strongest leverage point. And I think they need to use it here and let the chips fall where they fall. The media, I'm in Buffalo right now. OK, the media is going after India Walton very hardly, just like they went after Nina, just like they'll go after every progressive. So whether you fold or fight, they're always going to go after you. So why don't you fight?
Yeah. And I mean, it just seems like it's the same refrain over and over again. You mentioned the Obama years, right? It's like Joe Manchin is just the new Lieberman, right? Somebody that they can say, oh, we can't do anything because of this guy right here. But Bernie Sanders, you know, with this all this afforded all the same power that, you know, Joe Manchin is or Kyrsten Sinema, you know, his one vote in the Senate, you know, he is not going to play the role of the, you know, Joe Lieberman of the people, if you will. But to pivot to something you just mentioned, you said you're in Buffalo, New York, and obviously India Walton's campaign has been a breath of fresh air. She, you know, was able to, by astonishment to me, you know, win this primary. You know, it looks like she's in good shape to win the election. And I wanted to ask you one about the interview that you recently did when you spoke with her, but also ask what your opinion is about maybe, you know, pivoting the focus from dramatically being, oh, as a left and as a progressive movement, we are getting behind congressional candidates and we are getting behind, you know, national candidates to pass, you know, legislation. If we would be better served to, you know, work on a more community-based level and work on things like city council, like mayor, and build our way up from that level to tackle things on a state and local level where we might have, you know, less opposition from a national, you know, funder.
Yeah. Yeah, I think, you know, I think too many times it's painted on the left as like everything's mutually exclusive. Let's go all in on one and to hell with the other. I mean, I do not think just putting all our apples in presidential elections, Congress, Senate is going to take us to the promised land. We've seen that. With that said, if there's a good candidate like Anita Turner, I know people got pissed. She didn't go to the march, whatever. If there's a good candidate like Nina Turner, I mean, I don't see why you wouldn't support that candidate. We could go into her race if you want to. But to me, I think Bernie made a good point when he said it's from the bottom up. And I think a lot of people just kind of thought that was cheesy, but it's actually true because the truth is the system nationally and federally is so corrupt that it's not going, we're not going to structurally overtake the system in 4 years. I know people think about might say, oh, you're talking incrementalism. No, I'm talking reality. This is a corrupt country. It's taken 40, 50 years to become this corrupt. was not this corrupt in the mid 20th century. So I think on the local level with candidates like India Walton or district attorneys that have won in states like Pennsylvania and San Francisco, I think we should put a lot more of our emphasis because that's what will actually change your material life on the ground more. Your garbage cleanup, whether your YMCAs are open or closed, whether your youth centers are open or closed, whether, police are coming for mental health calls or you have social workers. So I do think elections like this, they're not sexy because they're not national. Pelosi is not involved, this and that. But they, to me, are even more important because it could actually change your conditions quicker on the ground. And that's why we're seeing, Schumer endorsed Walton. Schumer's doing whatever he can to avoid a primary from AOC. But the Democratic Party machine here is trying to stop her. They are basically like doing the bat signal to Republicans to come out and vote against her for Byron Brown. Byron Brown, the current mayor, is your dime a dozen corrupt Democrat who has sold the city to real estate developers. So I do think it's important for progressives. You know, I know a lot of people are angry and hopeless and say to hell with the whole electoral system. I get it. But there's not a lot of, you know, India Walton, if you hear her speak, if you look at her story, she's kind of the real deal. And I think for Buffalo, but the broader progressive movement, we need to start getting some W's on the board.
Yep. Oh, 100%.
That's the bottom line. You need to start getting W's on the board like these strikes to build momentum to get, it's like contagious in a good way, but you need to win. So I think this is a really important race. I was really impressed with her when I interviewed her. She also, I'll say, made a good point that a lot of progressives aren't going to like. I basically asked her, like, you know, what do you think? Because a lot of progressives feel the problem is, like Nina, for example, that she wasn't scorched earth enough. That's why she lost. And I was on the ground there and I said, actually, no, it was like a very pro-Biden, pro-Dem party area. So if she would have went figuratively guns a-blazing against Biden and the Democrats, she would have lost by 40. Some say, well, that's fine. We should fight anyway and just go scorched earth. And she made the good point, like, I don't have the privilege of living on a purity island. Like I need to meet people where they are, and not every door you're going to knock on is revolutionary behind the door. Right. Is most of them don't even like probably watch or even know our shows, or they're not really into politics that way.
Yeah.
So you have to tweak your message sometimes, and that doesn't always mean you're selling out.
Right. No, that's a very good point and great interview with India Walton. I'd urge all of our listeners to go check that out. I think she makes some really insightful points. Just to shout out a few super chats real quick. Thanks, M. Smith, for the $4.99. I put that link in the chat if you guys want to donate to the John Deere Strike Fund GoFundMe. Very important. And also, thanks so much for the $5. Cat status quo in the house. Absolutely. But yeah, to keep talking about India Walton a little bit, I'm really fascinated in this race. And obviously, if I was in Buffalo, not only would I enthusiastically vote for Walton, I would probably be campaigning for her as well. But I am interested in your estimation exactly how much change she will be able to bring as mayor, because, you know, here in Kansas City, where Zach and I live, the mayor is actually a kind of bullshit position. It's actually the unelected city manager, which controls the city more so, has more control, which is really insane. Also, here in KC, we're the only city where the police department is actually controlled from the capital of Jefferson, rather than here in Kansas City, which is totally insane. But needless to say, the mayor is just kind of it's not unimportant, but I don't know if, you know, our mayor could really bring any sort of like real socialist change. Maybe if he had like multiple terms and a long time to do it. But I'm just wondering what exactly you think India Walton can do as mayor. You know, she will be, if elected, which I think she will be, the first socialist mayor of a major U.S. city in decades. So I'm just wondering what exactly you think she can do to bring the kind of change she's looking to.
Sounds like there's some corruption in the water in Kansas City.
Massive trove.
I might need to come there. I don't want to like overshoot and say she's going to clean up the cesspool in a day. I do think mayor's races are, we could see more progress than, let's say, congressional races, because this is an executive, right? So there is no city manager in Buffalo. They actually have tried to create the position, not for the reason you think, but because the city council has voted for things here, and the current mayor that India Walton has already defeated once is basically just not abiding by their decisions and overruling them. So there is no city manager here. The second thing is, I mean, India Walton would have the authority to institute, you know, a 2-3% tax increase. Sure, the city council would have to play, you know, she'd have to get votes for the city council. But overall, the city council here in New York is different than Kansas City, is not all, you know, corporate establishment Democrats. There's been some progressives in there. So I think she would be able, it might not be completely what she wants in terms of 3%. She might be able to get 1.5% tax increase, but she can go a long way towards garbage delivery. Streets are a mess in terms of potholes, social services. She also, at least in Buffalo, the mayor does control the police department. So she can, I mean, they're throwing everything they can at her with defund, which is not just her. The corporate Democrats have been attacking progressives on that for years. But she can reallocate the police department. She has talked about cutting overtime. She has talked about shifting police officers so they're not responding to mental health issues, so they're not responding to things that should be dealt with, social workers, things like that. So there are things within her control that she can do. The other thing that she would have control over, and this is important, is contracts for development, because that is the mayor that ultimately controls that. And that is gentrification. It's not a sexy YouTube headline, gentrification. I actually hate the word because it's very vague. Let's just call it economic terrorism. That's what I call it. Gentrification is a huge reason we have the income inequality in this country that we do. Every city in America, from Kansas City to Pittsburgh to Flint, Detroit, Milwaukee, they are all being essentially a tale of two cities. Millions are poured into 5 to 10 blocks to create beautiful restaurants, bars, cultural centers, and the left of the city is left to rot. And the people that were born there and raised there have to move out because they can't afford it anymore. She would have the power to clean up the patronage system, which is Byron Brown basically handing out contracts to his donors, you know, like that, and actually have a fair bidding process and actually invest in affordable housing. So I do think she could do quite a bit. Listen, obviously, even if if Bernie Sanders was president today, folks, we would not have Medicare for all yet, because look at the push they're getting in Congress just for a modest climate bill or a modest Medicare expansion. He would have a fight. She will have a fight. But hey, you're in a better position if the mayor is a socialist, a nurse, somebody who has fought this gentrification. So I think overall, it wouldn't change Buffalo overnight, but it would certainly be a strong step in the right direction.
Yeah, I think that's, you know, really important for people to understand, because you're right. And one of the things that Gavin and I have talked about a lot recently is the fact that, you know, people need to be thinking more about local politics. You're incredibly right that if you make a video about YouTube local politics on YouTube, it's going to tank, right? It just doesn't have the algorithm sexiness that you need. But it is extremely important because it does impact people's lives in a real way. My girlfriend is a investigative reporter. That's what she does for a living. She recently did a piece on the vacant lot situation in Kansas City, where developers are basically getting free land east of Truce, which is the racial dividing line in Kansas City that has been for decades. The police terrorize everybody east of Truce. It's economically starved, whatever. They demolish the houses when they get run down, and then they will sell them to developers for literally like $50 to $75. And then in 15 years, that is a, you know, $75,000 lot that they'll sell to a developer, where a $250,000 home gets constructed, and then it's sold for $600,000. And everybody that lived east of that line for 50, 60, 70 years, they're all displaced. They now have to go live in some place like fucking Gladstone, which is way the fuck out past Kansas City in the middle of the sticks. And this is the kind of thing that a mayor who is rooted in a solidarity with the people, like India Walton, would be somebody who is not going to create a developer slush fund and, you know, like you said, spend millions of dollars on a 5-block strip of land where all of the rich people who participate in your tech show the city are living. Everybody else is going to have a seat at the table. Truly affordable housing can be constructed. And so I just think that's a lot of really important stuff that people should really remember.
And I also think, guys, and, you know, obviously it's tough on YouTube because, I mean, we're literally, status quo is hidden. I was talking to Gavin about it. We have 121,000 subscribers. We barely cracked 200 live viewers with India Walton. And literally, I have subscribers telling me all the time, they have to literally type in status quo. And even then, they can't find it. So I understand that these kinds of stories, YouTube, its design is to bury these kind of important stories. It is not sexy. It's a lot easier to do, you know, food fights, you know, between personalities. That's cool. And, you know, I need it sometimes just for relief from all this misery. But people need to understand the term organizing, I think, is overused sometimes. But on the local level, it's the only thing that matters, because honestly, whether it's Buffalo, whether it's Kansas City, this and that, the capitalist class and the plutocrats, exactly where they want you mentally is in fetal position. They want you to think it's too corrupt. Nothing's going to change. There's nothing I could do. And that's why they're rarely actually challenged. And they have the media. I mean, in Flint, literally nearly 8 years later, they still have dirty water and toxic water. And a large part of it is the media has sold the lie that it's fine now. Just like I'm sure in Kansas City and Buffalo, the local media is atrocious. So the only thing we can do, don't wait for the political Paul Revere to come, which is Bernie or the squad. I'm not saying totally check out of electoral politics, but in your local community, go to city council meetings. There rarely are activists at city council meetings. Confront your mayor, your city council, your city manager. Look at where the contracts are going. Look at, I don't want people's eyes to roll over. Look at the bond deals. A lot of these cities are executing bond deals where you, the taxpayer, are paying for bonds that the government is offering to pay for corrupt new projects that are going to benefit, wait for it, the developers. Hey, you want to do a general strike? Let's start in your community. Start boycotting specific, whether it's the grocery store in your community that's not treating workers' rights, whether it's the community bank that's screwing people. So a lot can be done in our community. And I do think, listen, with India Walton, with Nina Turner, with all these races, it ultimately comes down to voter turnout. The mayor's race in Buffalo in 2017, 16% turnout. 16% turnout in 2017. If people would get involved from the organizing standpoint, that immediately transfers over to these elections that only come every 3-4 years. So I think a lot can be done on our local level. I know that's not a sexy message. I know the big YouTube hosts don't push that. It's the truth. And I, you know, I don't know what's going to happen. A new poll came out yesterday that she was down by 18. I read it. Polling methodology, like a lot of these polls, is bullshit.
India Walton?
Yeah. I do think she's down. I don't think it's by 18. I'll also remind you, Cori Bush, the poll said she was down by 18 a week before, and she won. I read the poll.
Isn't Byron Brown not even actually on the ballot, though? Isn't it like a write-in?
Yeah, he's write-in. But
so you think he could still vanquish her as a write-in candidate?
Well, here's the thing. In the primary, he basically, you know, coasted. He didn't even campaign. So a lot of his voters didn't come out because he just took India Walton for granted. Mm-hmm. So the polling shows 43% of the poll that just came out were people who didn't vote in the primary. So my assumption is it's Byron Brown's base that slept through the primary, didn't vote, and are now coming out because he's realizing, oh, shit, I actually need to campaign. So all over Buffalo, you see these write down Byron Brown signs, lawn signs, this and that, because he's doing a writing campaign. It's not unprecedented. Lisa Murkowski won re-election in Alaska to the Senate, a write-in. But ultimately, I don't buy this poll. I don't think she's down by 18. I think right now, I think she's down just because I think it will be a much higher turnout than it was in the primary. But I do think it's a toss-up, and I think it's going to come down to turnout, and I think it's going to come down to, frankly, knocking on doors. Nina Turner lost for a lot of reasons. One of them was they did not really have a vibrant ground game. I mean, they just didn't. Her campaign doesn't like me saying that, but that's the truth. They had a lot of out of state people come in from the National Progressive Movement in the last 2-3 weeks. But you're talking 3-4 months before, they did not have that vibrant ground game. India Walton does have a strong ground game, but it's going to come down to who can knock on more doors. And also, unfortunately, how many Republicans vote for Brown.
Yeah, absolutely. And thanks so much for the super chat, CEB Apple. Really appreciate that. As well as Carol K. And thank you, John, for the $3. I don't believe the People's Party is against India Walton. I don't think they've waded into that race whatsoever. But yeah, that's interesting. I figured that she would basically walk away with the race, given that he was a write-in candidate and that she has those endorsements from the likes of Chuck Schumer and Kirsten Gillibrand and, you know, all that stuff. But that's interesting that it's closer than I realized. We'll definitely be, you know, continuing to cover the race, and that'll be really heartbreaking if she does lose.
I also should say, and I think this is for the future, next time the Democrats, you know, when it's name your pick, Pete Buttigieg, who they rigged the primary for, and he defeats, I don't know, whatever progressive. And then they tell you, you know, suck it up, you know, fall in line, unite. Well, this guy, he lost the primary. Say what you want about Joe Crowley, who lost to AOC. He went, you know, gracefully into the night to his lobbyist job. He didn't run a write-in campaign in the fall. So it seems that they say vote blue no matter who and unite if it's an establishment corporatist that wins the primary and the progressives are supposed to fall in line. Well, in this case, this guy lost fair and square, and they're trying to rig it where he could run as a write-in and get rid of the Democratic nominee who won. So that might be a dangerous thing for the Democratic Party, because don't ask people to fall in line
in
total fidelity if you're not going to do the same thing.
It reminds me of, I believe it was the Nevada DSA when they kind of took over the Democratic Party on the state level, and then they just like took all the money and, you know, left town. Definitely a similar situation. I did want to also talk about Stephen Donziger, who, as he tweeted out yesterday, let me put this up here, breaking, after 100 pages of legal briefing, the appellate court today denied my release in 10 words. This is not due process of law, nor is it justice. I must report to prison by tomorrow afternoon. That's today. We will get through this. So this is totally insane for multiple reasons. If you guys have been following this story, you'll know that disbarred lawyer Stephen Donziger, who was convicted of criminal contempt after a decades-long legal battle with Chevron Corp over rainforest pollution in Ecuador, will surrender to authorities after losing his bid to stay out of prison during his appeal. And that's, of course, after his, you know, lengthy house arrest. This is totally, totally fucking crazy. And Stephen Donziger is, of course, a hero for proving that Chevron poisoned indigenous people in Ecuador. And I know you've been covering this pretty closely, Jordan. Can you give us any insight from what's going on? Has Stephen, you know, has he reported to prison?
I don't know the actual hour by hour. I know he's supposed to report today. His appeal still is underway, but the judge has said that while his appeal is going on and that process is going on, he needs to report. Frankly, to me, covered a lot of corrupt things. I have never seen anything like, I've never, ever seen anything like this. I've always said we basically have three legal systems, one for, you know, well-to-do white people, another one for black, brown, indigenous. Now I have to say we have another legal system, and that's for environmental activists or environmental lawyers. Because this literally, you don't even have to be a lawyer. I've been covering this. A lot of it is complicated, but at the end of the day, unprecedented, every step of the way, multiple judges have done things that are not done in law. And essentially, obviously Trump's administration didn't care, but Merrick Garland, Biden's attorney general, there have been several politicians, including AOC, but some others that have written, you know, they love to write their letters to Merrick Garland, basically pointing out what I just pointed out. Man got no jury trial for a misdemeanor charge of contempt.
Yeah, can we talk about that really quick? For anybody who's been to, you know, court or jail, or, you know, I'm not trying to out anybody, right? But if you go and they tell you that there is a jail sentence attached to your crime, you are by law supposed to get a jury trial. That's how America is supposed to fucking work. That's like the one thing we're supposed to have. Am I wrong?
Absolutely. And it's all technicalities. Like, he didn't get a jury trial because it would jail sentence would only be up to 6 months. Oh, he's already been under house arrest for 2 years during a pandemic, by the way. You guys, I was depressed during the pandemic, but at least I could take a walk. I mean, this man has to get permission essentially to go to the bathroom. And it is obscene. And ultimately what this does, and we're seeing it with Assange too, is they are changing the paradigm. They are changing the discussion away from, in Assange's case, our war crimes. And in this case, literally a corporation murdering poor indigenous people across the world. In the court cases, you barely hear about what Chevron did, because they have basically, through, you're talking billions of dollars in legal, in public relations and marketing, totally changed it to this, to quote my dearly departed grandma, fakakta story that they conjured of Stephen Donziger, basically saying that he bribed an Ecuadorian judge to rule against Chevron. Literally every court backed up Ecuador's judgment. And that's the only reason, by the way, this lie that Chevron conjured up is the only reason that he even was ordered by a judge to give up his computer, cell phones, and this and that, based on a disproven bribery claim. So that's why he has been under a house arrest, and that's why he's going to jail, because he wouldn't give up his communications with clients. In the law, supposed to be confidential, he doesn't have to give them up. So every step of the way, this is really, really unprecedented. But most importantly for people, if you're watching and we're following Standing Rock, or you went to Standing Rock, or you've been on the front lines at Line 3, this is the criminalization of environmental protest. You could be an activist or you could be a lawyer. They're trying to criminalize environmental protest, just like they're trying to criminalize publishing war crimes, if you're Julian Assange. And this is why I asked Ro Khanna about it, because I think it's super important and progressives are doing jack shit about it. And frankly, Biden, all of this hashtag resistance hysteria over the last 5 years about the rule of law and Trump is trampling on the rule of law. He was. But what is this? Democrats are in charge now. Biden continued the Assange prosecution when Obama was no friend to journalists or whistleblowers. Even Obama's Department of Justice said, we can't do this. Biden's continuing it. A U.S. prosecutor, your audience should know this, a U.S. prosecutor declined to prosecute Stephen Donziger, saying there is no case here. Yet, this is still being allowed. Biden, Merrick Garland aren't doing anything. And I think it's dangerous, because people might say, all right, he'll be out in 6 months. But what does this do to other Stephen Donzingers who might think twice now? And by the way, Chevron has still not had to pay 1 cent for the people they poisoned, killed, for the people in Ecuador who have cancers, bodies deformed from drinking toxic. We are living in a fascist country.
And aren't they now trying to get the indigenous people to like pay for their court fees and shit?
You got it.
It's absolutely like criminal doesn't, you know, describe these actions, you know, villainous doesn't describe the actual lack of any sort of humanity that you have to have. Because I feel like you said, Jordan, they've done a very, you know, cognitive, intentional effort to cover up the crimes that, you know, first Texaco and then Chevron bought Texaco and, you know, Ecuador. They literally told these indigenous people, they knew they were poisoning them, and they said, don't worry, this is like milk. Like, I remember clearly there was, I heard Steve Donziger say that. I couldn't fucking believe my ears. Not only did they say, oh, this is harmless, they said, don't worry, this will actually benefit you. I mean, you have to have no human soul to go to a place where people have kept the environment in such a pristine condition, right? Especially in relation to how the developed world treats the environment, right? Indigenous people have tremendously more respect for the earth than we've ever had as a culture. And then to go there, destroy their environment, and then actively participate in their poisoning. I mean, these people need to be going up for murder trials. They need to be going up for serious crimes. And yet it's
genocide.
The people who actually fought against this. I mean, this is the most indicative of a corporate state that we possibly could have, right? I mean, a private judge without jury forcing a man to spend 2.5 years of his life in confinement, being disbarred. He can no longer practice law in the state of New York, which is where his home is. I mean, this is just a massive assault on any kind of remnants of liberty that we have. And I think it's fair, important to say that it has now reached the, you know, PMC class, the, people who can afford to have a career in, I think he went to a Ivy League university. I mean, this is a well-to-do guy, right? He's not low-income person that has no resources, right? This is the level of control that the corporate state has taken over. They will now treat all of us like they would treat only, you know, minorities or people who without resources in the past. And obviously, it's always been unethical with the treatment of minorities. But I think that just the increasing audacity of the corporate state to intervene at this high level with impunity is really scary.
Absolutely. And people might not realize, because I mean, the media certainly barely covered it. There's people literally that are in jail, Standing Rock activists with trumped up charges. I wasn't at Line 3, but I'm sure similar things. I mean, literally cities and states trying to criminalize protests where they are putting, you know, if you they're trying to put laws on the books where if you protest critical infrastructure projects, i.e. pipelines, you could get felony charges, 5 years in jail, $10,000 fines. Some states have tried to put in laws that if you, Gavin or Zach, run me, Jordan, over, I'm an environmental protest, you're good. No problem if you do that. So it's not just Donziger. This is a complete United Corporations of America, as I call it, corporate coup d'etat to try and basically the last stand for the fossil fuckers to try and prop up that last stand. And Donziger, who obviously, I mean, he spent 30 years of his life not fighting for the people in Ecuador and elsewhere. And literally, when you heard the judge's ruling, she has ties to Chevron. The prosecutor has ties to Chevron. She said he should be hit with a figurative 2x4. In between the eyes, like this is upside down sky, you know, sky is green kind of shit. And frankly, yeah, we want progressives to do a lot of things to play hardball on this and that. But our elected officials need to speak up a lot louder. I mean, when I interviewed Ro Khanna, he was kind of like, well, I need to look into the details of the indictment for Julian Assange. What do you need to look into? I don't care if you hate Julian Assange. I don't care if you do think he worked with Russia. He didn't. But I mean, at the end of the day, you know, he is the reason we know about the war crimes in Iraq and Afghanistan. And that's what those charges against Assange are about quote unquote, helping Chelsea Manning. And in terms of Stephen Donziger, well, if you're going to push for climate action, if you're going to push for serious investment in climate, don't you need to protect the people that are holding accountable the climate arsonists? Cause that's who Stephen Donziger is.
Yeah. Well, I know we're running up on our hour here, Jordan. I know you have to go interview some striking Starbucks employees, if that's correct, in Buffalo, which is something that we'll cover too. Hopefully play some of your reporting here on the Vanguard, some of those interviews, because that's also a great story that I'd love to get into if we had the time. But since I know that, you know, you've been experiencing a lot of that YouTube suppression and censorship, just wanted to give you a chance to, you know, tell our audience how they can support Status Quo's journalism, make sure you guys survive this, you know, tough time right now. Obviously, we're in between elections. A lot of this stuff is very heavy. It's depressing. You know, people aren't tuning in and that's not helped by the, you know, censorious suppressive algorithm. So again, if you just want to tell our supporters tell our listeners how to support Status Quo, keep you guys afloat during this time.
Yeah, thanks, guys. I'll just tell a really quick story so people understand that this is not just an algorithm. Literally, Status Quo started in 2018. Okay. We grew very quickly. I think we had like 6,000 subscribers in 2 weeks, which is pretty good for a brand new channel. Literally, I did a video, I think 2 weeks in, criticizing YouTube, I think because they wouldn't allow us to buy an ad or something. Boo! After I did that video criticizing YouTube, and literally since then, we're talking 3 years ago, our subscribers fell off a cliff. Our growth rate fell off a cliff. And it's gotten worse since then. We've had some peaks where when we're on the primary campaign trail or, you know, in a city where we're covering protests, we've seen gains. But overall, we have 121,000 subscribers. We're lucky at this point if we're cracking 200 live viewers on the road. And I've had to say to myself, wait, do people suddenly not care about this reporting? No, I've seen people don't actually see it. People, subscribers, I don't know about you guys, sometimes have to type in Status Quo to find it. We even have moderators on our channel, people in the chats that we've enabled to be moderators who don't get alerts when we're live. So I just ask everybody, you know, listen, I understand some people don't like my takes from time to time or other people's takes. It's fine. If you actually want to support on the ground reporting, if you can't financially support it, so be it. Subscribe to Status Quo. make sure you're on our text message list, because that's how we're getting around YouTube suppression. You're not going to get a notification from YouTube, but you'll get a text from us. That's statuscoup.com/text. But I think, honestly, as far as I know, there's not a lot of independent outlets actually going out there. And it's much needed, because honestly, what we're showing and the workers we're speaking to and the activists we're speaking to and the people in Flint we're speaking to, a huge reason we live in the United Corporations of America is because these people are not quoted in the New York Times. They're not on CNN. A lot of, like, my parents, I just use this as an anecdote. God bless them. They voted for Trump. Every single story I show them, one of the first things they say, why don't I see this on CNN? Why aren't like, even my dad, why isn't Fox covering this? Because they don't want you to fucking know, Dad. They don't want you to fucking know. So please support us, Status Coup, COUP on YouTube. Join our text list. We're going live in a half hour interviewing Starbucks workers. And I appreciate you guys having me on. I'd love to come on again.
Yeah, absolutely. Anytime you want to come on, Jordan, we obviously really admire your reporting. And, you know, as two people who have, you know, played around in the YouTube pool, we definitely know where the fuck the problems are. And we'd like to see people, you know, produce more on the ground content like you guys are doing. And obviously there's the financial barrier. There's the barriers as far as the censorship, YouTube algorithms, all that stuff. So it's really important that we all band together and keep Status Quo alive. One of the few lefty on the ground fucking journalistic projects that we have on the internet. So, you know, just huge solidarity to you guys and your team. Shout out to Jen, shout out to John, everybody else that, you know, I'm sure works hard, but I don't know their names off the top of my head. Really appreciate the work that you guys do, because it makes shows like The Vanguard possible, where we can talk about this reporting that we don't get to see on the mainstream news.
Thanks, guys. Appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks, Jordan. Have a good one. Great, great interview. Great time talking with Jordan, as always. Really so appreciate the work he's doing. And just when it comes to the stuff like Donziger, you know, it's been appalling the lack of mainstream media coverage on these cases. Same with the strikes, and Status Quo is there filling in those gaps for us, talking not just reporting on the stuff, but actually talking to the people that are most directly affected by these cases, by these stories, and that's so important. So if you guys haven't already, make sure to go over to Status Quo and give them a subscribe. Really important stuff. And yeah, just really glad to have Jordan on, as always, to hear some of his insights and reporting.
Yeah, absolutely. And shout out to Stephen Crow, who used to live on my block, apparently. I lived on Holmes, one block over from Truth. That's where I used to live. But anyway, shout out to you guys. Shout out to Jordan again. Really appreciate his time. We'll definitely reach out to him and get some updates on his reporting, have him back on the show. Always a good conversation. But until then, we'll probably be back tomorrow or the next day. You guys hit that subscribe button, hit the like button, and we'll shout out our patrons before hitting the road.
Yeah, absolutely. And also shout out to Progressive Michigander. Can't wait for Vanguard to start emulating Status Quo, do some on the ground reporting from our fabled van. Yes, that is coming in the near future. We do have our van, and we do plan on getting out there on the streets doing some reporting, kind of like what Jordan's been up to. So yeah, good stuff coming in the future as well. We both want to, you know, make sure we're contributing to that on the ground journalism and reporting ourselves, in addition to doing the show we already do. So yeah, appreciate everyone tuning in. Like Zach said, please hit that subscribe button. Please hit that like button if you haven't already. And a huge shout out to our patron community. We do shout out our patrons at the beginning and end of every single live stream. So if you want to hit up the link in the description, patreon.com/thevanguardchannel, and become either a comrade or Vanguardian level patron, you will be on the shout out screen again, which we show at the beginning and end of every live stream and at the end of all of our videos in the credits. Also offer our patrons our Discord server and early access to book clubs. Also, we have our monthly Q&A, which will be coming up here just in a couple days now. So good stuff. And again, that link's in the description. Huge shout out to everyone supporting the show. Really does make it possible. And again, just hit that like button, subscribe, notification bell if you haven't already. That's a great way to help as well. But yeah, thanks everyone for tuning in today. Hope you all have a great rest of your Wednesday, and we'll see you next time.
Yeah, peace out, everybody.